Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Women in the Bible, Interpretation, Resources for the Use of Scripture in the Church, by Jaime Clark-Soles. Narrated by Erin Bennett. Publisher's note: in this audio edition, you will hear references to charts present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Introduction. We begin this journey on a celebratory note for two reasons. First, today women are exercising leadership in churches across a number of denominations. Second, much scholarship has been published in the area of women in the Bible over the past two decades, so that our knowledge has grown and the subject has become mainstream rather than ancillary. For example, we now have the CEB Women's Bible, a one-volume study Bible that combines excellent scholarship with attention to the complexity of contemporary lived reality. In addition, the new Wisdom Commentary series, an ongoing project that will cover the entire Bible in 58 volumes through the lens of feminist scholarship, testifies to our explosion in knowledge, the refinement of interpretive approaches, and the exciting potential for individual, communal, and global transformation to which the gospel surely calls us. Challenges remain, of course. First, many traditions still do not ordain women and continue to reinforce gender roles in ways that perpetuate inequality. In many Christian traditions today, women are not permitted to preach and teach the gospel in any formal capacity. Part of the argument against women in leadership comes from passages of the Bible, especially 1 Timothy chapter 2, 1 Corinthians chapter 14 verses 33 through 36, and the household codes of Ephesians. Such authors drew upon their predecessors from both Jewish and non-Jewish sources, from Aristotle and Hippocrates, to the biblical texts, to Josephus, the church fathers, Luther, Calvin, and so on down to today. One can adduce an endless collection of choice quotations to prove that women have been considered inferior to men. A few examples will suffice. Quote, males are warm, dry, and firm, and this is the norm. Females are cold, moist, and spongy, these being defects. Source: Hippocrates, 5th to 4th century BCE. Quote, females are weaker and colder in their nature, and we should look upon the female state as being, as it were, a deformity. Source: Aristotle, 4th century BCE. Quote, the law says that the woman is in all things inferior to the man. Let her accordingly be submissive, for the authority has been given by God to the man. Source: Josephus, 1st century CE. Quote, the female sex is irrational and akin to bestial passions, fear, sorrow, pleasure, and desire. Source: Philo of Alexandria, 1st century CE. Quote, praised be God that he has not created me a Gentile. Praised be God that he has not created me a woman. Praised be God that he has not created me an ignorant man. Source: Tosefta Berakoth, 7, 8. Quote, it is not proper for a woman to speak in church, however admirable or holy what she says may be, merely because it comes from female lips. Source: Origen, 185 to 254 CE. Quote, the rule remains with the husband, and the wife is compelled to obey him by God's command. He rules the home and the state. The woman, on the other hand, is like a nail driven into the wall. She sits at home. Just as the snail carries its house with it, so the wife should stay at home and look after the household. Source: Martin Luther, 16th century CE. Quote, the woman had indeed been subject to her husband in paradise, though this was an honest and by no means harsh subjection. But now, after the fall, she is placed, as it were, in slavery. Source: John Calvin, 16th century CE. Far from picking on any one tradition, my point here is to demonstrate the ubiquity of such attitudes toward women by movers and shakers across the board, whose effects are felt to this day. Second, there are many more women in the Bible than you may realize, but chances are that you have not heard of many of them because they are not mentioned in our teaching and preaching. Third, when you do hear of a woman in the Bible, the woman is often presented as a sinner and is often associated with some kind of sexual immorality, even Jesus' mother. Fourth, rarely do we hear of women who lead and are moral or faith exemplars. Those we do encounter often have been so egregiously misinterpreted that it would be better if they had stayed ignored, for example, Mary Magdalene and the Samaritan woman. These patterns in the Bible raise some questions for us Christians and our witness. First, there is the issue of how God is described and portrayed. Does God believe that women are not equal to men and that most women are sexpots and seductresses? Second, based on the answer to the first question, do followers of God have license to constrain women on the basis of gender? Third, how do we entertain the issue of the unity and authority of the Bible? Not all texts agree. Some are liberating for women, and some appear to condone or engender oppression. How do we address this? Goals of the book. The Bible has been a resource in the struggle for gender equality and, by extension, people equality. The rising of women means the rising of the whole human family. When Christians talk about anything, including women, we are talking about the nature of the kingdom, or dream of God. Where does the Bible exemplify good news of abundant life for women and point the way to how life would look if things were on earth as it is in heaven? Since the Bible is scripture for us, it has special authority. But how does that authority work, given the distance between the time and cultures in which it was composed and now? It is important to know how women were viewed in ancient society so that we can inquire about which aspects of that view inhere in the present and which aspects might be cast off. Paul asked women to veil in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, but most American women do not do that today. What was at stake then, and why do most of us not do it now? So, the Bible is authoritative. The Bible teaches us about the nature of God's kingdom, and history can help us think about how we relate to the Bible today. This book spotlights overlooked women and takes a fresh look at some of the most commonly referenced women. I address women who are astute theologians. I feature women who are active agents, those who are victims of forces beyond themselves, and those who are both. I try to be honest about what the texts do and do not say, whether we like it or not, and whether we decide to agree or disagree with the author on any given point. I also point out different types of family structures in the Bible. After all, neither Jesus nor Paul ever married or had children, and Paul patently calls Christians not to marry if they can at all resist it. Unmarried people in the Bible are whole people on their own. On the other hand, Peter is married. Some women are mothers, and some are not. Some are leaders in their communities, judges, warriors, prophets, apostles, ministers, leaders of prayer circles, and churches. Others are ordinary people like the rest of us, trying to live faithful lives amidst sometimes difficult circumstances, celebrating and praising God for the joys that attend our lives, such as finding a coin or seeing a brother raised to new life. The stated goals of this book are as follows. 1. Address well-known biblical women. Where necessary, reintroduce such figures from fresh perspectives using a variety of interpretive methods. 2. Lift up stories of women that have been ignored. 3. Reinstate biblical women who have been erased, rather than merely ignored, due to political moves in textual transmission, such as Junia, or through politically motivated translation moves of which the English listener may not even be aware, for example, Phoebe. 4. Consider symbolic feminized figures such as Woman Wisdom in Proverbs, Daughter Zion, and the Great Whore in Revelation. 5. Explore the ways the Bible employs feminine imagery and the ways it moves across or beyond gender. For example, God, Jesus, Paul, and the male disciples are depicted using feminine language. When feminists speak of reclaiming the feminine aspects of salvation history, the common reaction is that one is somehow changing either scripture or tradition. In fact, many feminists are merely asking that the fullness of the scriptures and tradition be recognized within the public prayer of the church. 6. Draw upon recent scholarship that addresses the status of women in ancient Israelite society, in Roman Palestine, and the empire more broadly, and in the early church. 7. Present insights from new perspectives that have emerged in the interpretive conversation through the growing attention to women in the Bible and the increasingly active participation of women in different social locations in the current global context. 8. Point the listeners to excellent resources for further study. Ideally, the book will cause listeners to know more, incorporate the material into their faith life, and help others to do the same. Texture of the book. While the stated goals of the book have been previously enumerated, the listener might fairly ask about some of the overarching commitments that undergird the project. First, I am a New Testament scholar, and the book is weighted more heavily in the New Testament direction as a result. Indeed, the longest, most detailed chapter is devoted to women in Jesus' ministry. Second, of all the things I could have addressed, I have tried to choose what is most useful and urgent for those called to lead groups of people in engaging Scripture. How might engaging these texts deepen our discipleship and allow us to encounter God? How might we encounter the texts in different settings in the life of the church? Third, I assume a stance of reading toward wholeness and liberation for everyone and everything in God's creation. This entails being honest about potential obstacles to said liberation. Patriarchy constitutes one such entrenched obstacle, both in antiquity and in our contemporary society. Patriarchy, literally rule by the father, is a system in which men rule by virtue of being male. The a priori assumption in this book is that patriarchy always disadvantages women and is inherently unjust insofar as political and economic power is not distributed evenly. Patriarchy is, by definition, sexist, and sexism is unjust. Thus, when I use the language of equality, or lack of, in this book, I refer to having agency and equal access to the power to shape societal structures that affect one's ability to survive and flourish. It is the nature of scholarship itself for scholars to debate ideas and evidence in order to advance human knowledge. This book, however, is written not merely as a disinterested historical analysis or a summary of scholarly debate on women in the Bible. Rather, as stated earlier, it is written for the sake of communities for whom these biblical texts are currently authoritative in some way, shaping the moral, intellectual, and emotional lives of contemporary people. Thus, I will spend very little time rehearsing arguments from every scholarly angle. Two specific examples may help. Dr. Carol Myers, a Hebrew Bible scholar whose work informs my own, suggests that we should use the word heterarchy rather than patriarchy in order to draw attention to the fact that women had a more active role and more agency in society during the Old Testament period than we generally imagine. Likewise, Dr. Susan Hyland, my esteemed New Testament colleague and editor of this volume, tends to argue for a more optimistic view of women's power and agency in the biblical period than we generally imagine, while still noting that women were considered inferior and that the society was patriarchal. I respect, rely upon, and recommend the work of both scholars as they seek to nuance our historical knowledge. Yet I remain concerned not to soften gender disparities in our own era, inherited from thousands of years of reading these very biblical texts. It may be that not all scholars are using the word power in the same way. On the one hand, I understand the argument that women have power when they influence their husband's choice about whom their daughter should marry, or donate money to a civic organization. When I use the word power, however, I mean the power of a woman to make and enforce laws that affect her and her children. Self-determination with respect to her body and who has access to it and what kind of access. The same standards for morality that apply to men rather than a double standard. The same consequences, or lack of, for particular actions, and so on. One even reads arguments, not from Myers or Hylan, trying to soften the inherently oppressive nature of patriarchy by appealing to benevolent patriarchy, or something similar. I consider benevolent patriarchy an oxymoron in any century, in any locale, and that assumption underlies the book. We have inherited patriarchy along with its concomitant dangers. To be sure, there have been moments of light, but then, as now, trying to point out bright spots or to dull the razor-sharp edges of patriarchy, far from making it safer, lulls us into obscuring the deadly force it has always been for women. Given our subject, then, I address the potential promises and pitfalls of the biblical texts under consideration with respect to ancient audiences and later interpreters, including us. I ask, in what ways does the text have liberative potential, and in what ways does it present potential obstacles for those seeking abundant life? John chapter 10, verse 10. Challenges of the book. Undertaking such a project requires addressing numerous complexities. Here are some of the issues that arose in conceptualizing and producing it. 1. Gender constructs. One could argue that it is outdated to speak of women in the Bible. Rather, it is now more common to speak of gender in the Bible. To pull out women in the Bible draws attention to the fact that, even now, male is the normal, unmarked, unremarkable category. The norm. Gender in the Bible helps us to avoid reinforcing the masculine as normative and the feminine as some kind of noteworthy exception to the norm. I want to avoid gender essentialism, the idea that each gender is marked by inherent and distinctive traits or characteristics. I find it curious that many books, including excellent ones that I adduce in this work, try to categorize ancient women: helpmates, harlots, and heroes, or goddesses, whores, wives, and slaves, for example. There appears to be no urge to categorize men in this way. Such categorizing risks presenting females, in the literary texts and historical record, as flat, stereotyped characters without individuality. Gender is a social construct. As Hylan explains, what it means to be male or female is not a biologically given category that endures through time, but is constructed by culture, often with political, social, and religious ramifications. In every culture, people make sense of their experiences and the world around them, and in doing so, they construct understandings of what it means to be male or female. That fact raises a question about where the category women fits into the LGBTQIA+ conversations about gender identity and performance, biological sex, and so on. If such terms are new to you, consult the glossary in A Brief Guide to Ministry with LGBTQIA Youth by Cody J. Sanders. For instance, we will find that God, Jesus, Paul, and the male disciples are depicted in categories that cross traditional gender notions. That is not to say, however, that the ancients did not have binary notions of male and female identity. In this book, we will understand the texts from the perspectives of the ancient authors and culture, as well as raise questions related to our own contemporary appropriation of these texts. To speak of women is to speak of gender and sexuality and personhood. It is to speak of procreation and family structures and social structures and embodiment and incarnation and choices and power and lack thereof and economics and race and ethnicity and anything else that pertains to the human condition. That's a tall order. 2. What about women in the Bible? The next issue is one of scope and focus. On the one hand, there are many women in the Bible, usually where we expect them, sometimes where we might not. There are hundreds of named and unnamed women in the Bible, and it would be impossible to treat them all. The indexes of named and unnamed women in the excellent Common English Bible, Women's Bible, list 344 women, 178 named, 166 unnamed. In choosing what to present, I must also choose what not to present, necessarily excluding other fascinating material. On the other hand, women are missing, and the missing women should matter as much as the present women. None of the 12 named disciples is female. No females are depicted at the Transfiguration, the Last Supper, or the Garden of Gethsemane. The story of the prodigal son names no females. Was there no mother? Were there no sisters? The special 144,000 in Revelation are all virgin males, these who have not defiled themselves with women, chapter 14, verse 4. And Matthew tells us that the women and children at the feeding of the 5,000 did not count, literally. And the ones who ate were about 5,000 men, aner, not including, chorus, women and children. Chapter 14, verse 21. My translation. I am somewhat tempted to call this book Women in the Bible and not. In addition to so much material to address in the biblical texts themselves, there are also now many good, useful books on women in the Bible. I direct the listener to a number of them. Given the availability of these resources, I have chosen to shape this volume according to the specific goals I provide in this chapter, without trying to accomplish what has already been achieved elsewhere. 3. Nature of the evidence. The type of evidence available presents challenges for those desiring a full picture of women's lives in biblical times. First, most of the evidence tells us only what elite men thought or imagined about women's lives, if they thought about them at all. It assumes certain notions of what constitutes an ideal woman for a given social context. When we do find the rare piece of evidence from a woman herself, it usually comes from a woman of the elite echelons of society. We have almost no direct evidence from the lives of ordinary women, and only scant from elite women. Thus, there is no easy answer to the common question, what was it like to be a woman in the biblical period? It depended, in part, on a woman's social location. Was she a wife, a widow, a slave, a queen, a judge, or an ordinary woman? We will consider women in these different categories. Second, scholars do not all agree in their construal of the evidence. Third, we are working across a number of centuries, especially with respect to the Old Testament period, which covers about 1,500 years. Social conditions and norms can change over time, potentially altering some aspects of women's lives. 4. Audience. The danger of writing a book called Women in the Bible is that potential readers and listeners may think that the book is primarily for women. While it is primarily about women, the book is for everyone. I do not want this only to be a book by a woman, for women, about women. Rather, I want people of all genders to use it. Material related to women or the feminine, like material related to other genders, should be considered a resource for addressing the human condition. Surely men are to imitate the behavior of faithful women, like the widow with her mite, the Canaanite woman, and the Samaritan woman. As Ruth Fox avers, just as men are held up as spiritual models for women, how many sermons have we heard on the faith of Peter? So, too, men's spirituality is enriched and aided with feminine patterns of holiness. Women have been using their analogical imaginations for centuries now. That is, they take material specifically addressed to men and translate it into their own lives. For instance, the Gospel of Matthew praises those who are eunuchs for the kingdom, chapter 19, verse 12, my translation. Eunuchs are castrated males. But women have worked by analogy to read this as a call to celibacy, which they have answered over the centuries. Are male listeners also willing to use their analogical imaginations? Structure of the book. I begin the book by using Matthew chapter 15 to display a variety of hermeneutical methods and considerations relevant to this project as a whole. It's an invitation into a world of rich conversations and a chance to turn the text around and around as if it were a diamond in the light in order to see the various facets. Then I move to God, consideration and experience of whom undergirds the whole interpretive process. I especially focus upon the ways God moves across gender in our scriptures. Next, I address a perennial issue for scripture readers and people living in every age, women and violence. It was not an easy chapter to write, and I imagine it won't be the easiest to get through. I kindly ask the listener, however, to stay with me through the women and violence chapter. I promise you will be rewarded and refreshed by the women creating chapter that immediately follows. Next, I address the book of Ruth as an example of one of the books of the Bible named after a female. The complexities and beauty of life and relationships present themselves, with special attention to the relationships about women therein. Next, I turn to the women who appear in Jesus' life and ministry, along with consideration of the ways that Jesus himself, and sometimes his disciples, moves across gender at certain places in our scriptures. Likewise, I write about the women in Paul's life and ministry and the ways that he, too, is presented as one whose capacities defy ancient gender concepts. Finally, I explore the Deutero-Pauline texts as they relate to the topic of women in the Bible. In the spirit of Ralph Waldo Emerson's declaration that a foolish consistency is the hobgoblin of little minds, I have not sought to subject the book or individual chapters to a contrived consistency. Rather, I have presented the content that I think is most useful laid out in an order that I think is most useful. Ideally, the listener would listen to the book in order from start to finish. However, I've tried to write the book in a way that would enable a person preaching or teaching in a specific area to use a relevant chapter on its own. Assumptions about my listeners. You are people who are well-read and love learning. If you are clergy, you have probably gone to seminary. If you are a lay leader, you are that person who always goes deeper into the complexity of a subject. All of you care about the gospel of Jesus Christ and pray that God's will be done on earth as it is in heaven. That is a big ask, but you have been called to work toward that vision and equipped to do so by God, Christ, and the Holy Spirit. Scripture is no small part of that equation. How might attention to women in the Bible help us to discern and enact God's will on earth as it is in heaven? You have been taught to consider both what the text meant in its original socio-historical context by its original author for the original audience, and also what the text means today for the church in the world. You live in a time in which you and your community have unprecedented access to an overwhelming amount of information. It used to be that you could simply rely on the standard commentaries written by a single author from a single perspective, usually employing the historical critical method undergirded by modernist assumptions. Notice that most commentaries in a library reference room are by males. Now you work in a postmodern context in which a plethora of methodologies have yielded new questions and approaches and insights, and voices from across the globe have entered the conversation. You are tasked with helping others navigate a complex world where politics, religion, gender, sexuality, economics, race, technology, and global forces factor into everyday lives. The moral issues you address are weighty. Sex trafficking, reproductive rights, end-of-life decisions, proper use of technology, pluralism, war, care for the least of these, the alien and sojourner in your land. You do not have the luxury of burying your head in the sand and pretending that we live in a simpler time, if we ever did, and a small world where everyone thinks like we do. Your guidance and preaching and teaching are needed more than ever, as unprecedented numbers of people have no knowledge of or connection to the life-giving power and genius that the Bible holds. Wisdom from the ages, both pain and promise, breathtaking failures, and astonishing moments of mystery and redemption. The lectionary. When we Christians gather for worship, how often do we hear biblical texts related to women? If one comes from a tradition that does not use a lectionary, the pastor chooses which texts are heard when the church gathers and can, therefore, choose whether to exclude or include women. It is my hope that pastors who use this book will review how often, in what ways, and to what ends the women of the Bible appear in the church's life with Scripture, and will expand the exposure the congregations get to the wide variety of women who appear in our canon. On the other hand, if one does follow a lectionary, one may encounter some women, but there are real obstacles to presenting the full picture of women in the canon. The challenge of the lectionary. In the biblical text, women are rarely central in the stories compared to men. The problem is exacerbated by the lectionary tradition. In this book, I refer to both the Revised Common Lectionary, used by Protestants, and the Roman Lectionary, used by Catholics. The lectionaries differ. J. Frank Henderson's Remembering the Women, Women's Stories from Scripture for Sundays and Festivals, is a great starting point for an in-depth review of problems with the lectionary. It provides some history of the lectionary, both the Roman Lectionary and the Revised Common Lectionary, especially as it pertains to the presence and absence of women's stories therein. Women's stories are more absent than present, to the detriment of both women and men whose faith lives are shaped by the liturgy of the church. This absence of women includes the following. 1. Including only a limited selection of the women's books, especially in Sunday readings. 2. Omitting many stories of the Bible that feature women. 3. Omitting verses featuring women from passages used as lectionary readings. 4. Listing some passages that feature women only as optional or alternative readings. Other problems with the presentation of women in the lectionary relate to how women are portrayed in biblical passages and whether their inclusion or exclusion from the lectionary is helpful or dangerous. When negative stories about women are included and positive stories omitted, surely this inhibits the celebration of women in ministry doing the work of God and reinforces negative stereotypes about women. On the other hand, if some of the Bible's challenging passages about women are omitted from the lectionaries, and especially Sunday readings, when will the corporate body of believers ever deal with these difficult passages, speaking honestly about the harm they have done and can do? Will believers simply have to decide how to interpret such texts on their own? Solutions for the problems with the lectionary. To help solve the problem of women's absence from the lectionaries, Henderson's book is arranged according to the logic of the lectionaries, which is explained in detail in the introduction. Women's stories that already are part of the lectionary are capitalized upon and expanded. Those that have been omitted are now included, according to a set of four principles. 1. Stories taken from the same biblical book or closely related material from other books. 2. Theological relationships with the festival or season. 3. Passages that employ feminine images of God. 4. Passages that refer to holy wisdom. The book provides an appendix with excerpts from some psalms that use feminine images of God. Another appendix is an index of scripture readings in three columns. Column 1 lists the scripture readings in canonical order. Column 2 names the Sunday or festival on which Remembering the Women suggests use of the passage. Column 3 shows the relationship with the Roman lectionary and Revised Common Lectionary and, on occasion, other lectionaries. A third appendix includes three essential essays related to women in the lectionary by Jean Campbell, OSH, Ruth Fox, OSB, and Eileen Schuler, OSU. In their essays, Fox and Schuler suggest the following ways to include more women in Christian engagement of the Bible. 1. Choose to read the long versions of the Gospel. 2. Preach on the full text, including omitted texts. 3. Use texts including women on other occasions. For example, if anointing the sick, read from the story of the woman anointing Jesus. When commissioning music ministers, use the example of Miriam or Judith leading singing. 4. Open and close meetings with Esther or Judith's prayers or portions of the Magnificat. 5. Expand opportunities for Bible study. The Sunday readings at Mass can never be the only context in which we experience the Bible. There is a real need for small group Bible study, catechetical and adult learning programs to provide an arena for people to explore the full scope of what the Bible says about women. Here, we can bring our own experiences to interact with the text in ways which are not possible with the parameters of the Sunday Eucharist. In addition to reading the essays in Remembering the Women, I recommend that the listener who wants to counter the problems with the lectionary learn what is excluded or relegated to a basically unheard status. Make use of resources that mind the gap for you, such as Women's Psalms and In Her Own Right. In preaching and teaching, engage difficult texts about women creatively and by pairing them with positive texts. Speak boldly about what is excluded, whether those texts have positive or negative images, to reinforce life-giving perspectives about women in the Bible and beyond. In this volume, I direct listeners to material related to women in the Bible so that they can choose to present those passages in sermons and liturgical events. That is, I highlight material already in the lectionary. In addition, I present some of the important women or aspects of womanhood in the Bible that are excluded from the lectionary. This two-way method should, God willing, make it easier for those who lead worship or education to find ways to include more of the material related to women in the Bible in the life of the church and in their own personal study. Conclusion: Truth with Hope. Of all the women in the Bible, Pollyanna is not one of them. So in the chapters that follow, I aim to have an honest conversation with you about what kinds of things the Bible says and does not say about women, who is present and who is absent, what the text actually says and what interpreters have said it says. I want to provide information and point you to some excellent resources for further study. In many ways, I want to stoke your imagination and inspire you to come at the subject from a variety of angles, each yielding different fruit for different seasons. It will have to be done in a representative, not exhaustive, fashion, of course. If I am successful, you may learn something new about particular women or groups of women in the Bible. More importantly, I hope that you will be equipped to imaginatively consider these women from more angles than you might have before, and, as a result, that the scriptural text will spark your imaginations about how we might live better, more just, or righteous lives today. I suppose I consider myself the scribe of whom Jesus speaks in Matthew chapter 13, verse 52. Therefore, every scribe who has been trained for the kingdom of heaven is like the master of a household who brings out of his treasure what is new and what is old. Something old, something new. May you find some of each in the chapters that follow. Chapter 1. Of Canaanites and Canines. Matthew chapter 15. So many passages in the Bible are relevant to our topic that it is impossible to cover each one or even all possible interpretations of a single passage. However, I want listeners to have a sense of the variety of approaches that are available to a contemporary interpreter. There isn't a single right answer for a given passage, so the task isn't to make one correct interpretation. Rather, we readers can learn to make various interpretive decisions, understanding that we might revisit and revise those conclusions at a later reading. The story of the Canaanite woman in Matthew chapter 15, verses 21 through 28, admits of polyvalent interpretation to a stunning degree. 1/4 of the essays in the Feminist Companion to Matthew are devoted to it. In what follows, we review the story, offering some comments along the way, note varieties of interpretations, draw conclusions about the significance of the variety of interpretations, and tie the chapter into the stated goals of the book. The story. Immediately preceding this story, Jesus is in Gennesaret, northwest corner of the Sea of Galilee, Matthew chapter 14, verse 34, where he addresses the issue of defilement. It's not what goes into the mouth that defiles, but rather what comes out, Jesus says, because what comes out of the mouth proceeds from the heart, chapter 15, verse 18. The heart is the gold standard for judging. Notice that the offenses he names, including slander, involve mistreating others. This is something to keep in mind when Jesus calls the woman a dog later in Matthew 15. In the two passages that follow ours, Jesus heals and feeds. His experience with the woman is catalytic. Jesus leaves Gennesaret and proceeds to the area of Tyre and Sidon, which is significant because that is predominantly Gentile territory. Not only is the woman who approaches Jesus a Gentile, then, but Matthew further labels her a Canaanite, an extremely loaded, if anachronistic, term. The Canaanites were among the most hated enemies of ancient Israel, although there were no longer any Canaanites per se in the first century. The term is a slanderous one, a point made more starkly if one compares Matthew's version to its source, Mark, which simply calls her Syrophoenician. First, as Gail O'Day suggests, Matthew lumps Tyre and Sidon together as a region. Mark mentions them separately in chapter 7, verse 24, and chapter 7, verse 31. To evoke the Old Testament vitriol against Israel's old enemies. In the prophetic literature of the Old Testament, Tyre and Sidon are more than place names. They were Israel's dangerous and threatening enemies. For example, Isaiah chapter 23, Ezekiel chapters 26 through 28, Joel chapter 3, verse 4. Second, Matthew employs the Canaanite slur, though Tyre and Sidon were real Gentile places in the first century, unlike Canaan. So, Matthew is maximizing the unclean Gentile theme here. The woman is not simply other. She is intensely other. And she's a loud mother other. She shouts a command to Jesus using some of Matthew's favorite words, "Have mercy on me, Lord." Eleison me kyrie, Matthew chapter 15, verse 22. 8 of the 15 occurrences of mercy in the Gospels occur in Matthew, 4 in Luke, 3 in Mark, 0 in John. And Lord is a Christological confessional title in Matthew. In fact, often where Mark has someone call Jesus teacher, Matthew changes it to Lord. Next, the woman calls Jesus Son of David. Why is this important? Matthew alludes to David and his relationship to Jesus far more than any other gospel. Son of David is one of the most important Christological titles in Matthew. So this woman gets it with her doubly correct Christological confession. The title Son of David links this Canaanite woman to the understanding of Jesus expressed back in Matthew's genealogy, which ties Jesus directly to David through an ancient Canaanite woman, Rahab. That is, Rahab and Salmon begat Boaz, Ruth and Boaz begat Obed, Obed begat Jesse with an unnamed woman, Jesse begat David with an unnamed woman. A lot of begetting, which takes two, of course, even though the genealogy focuses on men. That's all the more reason to take note of the exceptional spots where women are named, including the Canaanite Rahab, the foremother of Jesus himself, and also, in some ways, the Canaanite woman in the story, given that only Matthew insists that the woman who engages Jesus is a Canaanite. In fact, the genealogy is one of the most important and rich texts in the New Testament for appraising the topic of women in the Bible. For more on Matthew's genealogy, consult chapter 7, Women in Jesus' Life and Ministry. I particularly appreciate Stuart Love's treatment of the ways the genealogy connects to our passage, as well as the ways our passage is inextricably tied to the hemorrhaging woman in Matthew 9. He argues, "The Canaanite woman's story remains a significant memory for the Matthean community. Old external, internal boundaries have been crossed or are being challenged." Further, he asks, "But what can be said about marginal, non-Israelite women in this contentious, polemical, fluid, and uncertain period? Does the Canaanite woman's story provide a social transparency of a gender issue being faced by Matthew's community?" After rehearsing some of the history of scholarly interpretation of the genealogy, Love suggests that the four women in the genealogy have more in common with the Canaanite woman in Matthew 15 than they have in common with Mary. He also asserts, "We believe the inclusion of these women in the genealogy anticipates the surprise and scandal of the Canaanite woman's story. But as in the time of Jesus, who as an Israelite healer had difficulty negotiating his own defined boundary limits, only to Israel, so now the Matthean community must pass through its own boundary taboos by accepting outcast non-Israelite women. Following the model, her example upsets the order of the social system." In this view, then, the Canaanite woman represents women who are out of bounds in some way, and the conversation taking place in Matthew's own late first century community about where such women fit into the new community. After she calls Jesus Son of David, the New Revised Standard Edition has the Canaanite woman telling Jesus that her daughter is tormented by a demon, chapter 15, verse 22. That translation does not convey the full force of the language here. "Evilly demonized" would be better. This is deeply harrowing, excruciating language. The adverb kakos comes from the adjective that means evil or wicked. The verb daimonizomai shows that the daughter is a victim who is acted upon. The Greek present tense emphasizes the ongoing nature of the situation, such that we could justifiably add the word constantly. Notice that the woman asks for mercy on herself, not her daughter. Anyone who has watched someone who is their very heart suffer will understand her choice of words. Is there a more heart-wrenching scene in the Bible? How does Jesus react to the mother's cry for mercy? The text says, "But he did not answer her a word," chapter 15, verse 23, my translation, period. While we may want to fill in felt gaps here, to do so is to add to the text, and that move should be overtly acknowledged. Jesus remains silent. How do the disciples react to the mother's cry for mercy? They do not talk to her at all. Rather, they talk about her, presumably right in front of her. They, unlike the woman, approach Jesus with no honorific title, just a command of their own: "Send her away." Why? "Because she is repeatedly crying out after us," my translation. That is the sole reason given. They find her an annoying bother. Finally, she gets a response from someone: Jesus. He delivers the unfortunate, for her as a Gentile, news. "I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel," chapter 15, verse 24. When you picture the exchange, is Jesus saying this to the woman, to himself, to the disciples, to some or all of the above? The text does not specify. At any rate, the statement is entirely in keeping with Matthew's understanding of both Jesus's and his disciples' mission, as the reader recalls from Jesus' command to his disciples in chapter 10, verses 5 through 6, Go nowhere among the Gentiles, and enter no town of the Samaritans, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Indeed, Matthew's genealogy squarely ties Jesus to Judaism, from King David all the way back to Father Abraham. Only Matthew specifies that the child is to be named Jesus because he will save his people from their sins. Chapter 1, verse 21. Jesus is a Jewish Messiah for Jewish people. After Jesus' pronouncement, he stops speaking to the woman or about the woman. Nevertheless, she persists. She approaches Jesus, prostrates herself before him. Proskuneo has a number of meanings, including worship, calls him by an honorific title, Lord, again, and issues another imperative from beneath him, Help me, chapter 15, verse 25. The text then says that Jesus answers. Again, it does not specify to whom Jesus is speaking. Is he speaking to her directly or to someone else, the disciples, himself? Pay attention to what he says. It is not good to take the children's bread, artos, and cast it to the little dogs. Chapter 15, verse 26, my translation. The children are those belonging to the house of Israel. The dogs are non-Jews. She takes the comment as directed to her and responds, for the third time calling him Lord. She absorbs the slander of being called a dog and rolls with Jesus' logic in order to defeat his argument. Yes, Lord, Kyrie, but even the little dogs eat the scraps of the things that fall from the table of their lords, Kurios. Chapter 15, verse 27, my translation. Note that the children sit at the table. The proper place for a dog is on the ground, where she is as she says this. For the first time since the story began, the text notes that Jesus answers her directly. In chapter 15, verse 28, he calls her woman, the only place in Matthew where he does this, and extols her. Great is your faith. He then issues a command. Let it be done for you as you wish. The story ends thus, and from that hour her daughter was healed. Eiomai, my translation. In the chapter before ours, Jesus feeds bread, artos, to a multitude, and heals many people in his own Jewish territory. Immediately following, the reverse happens. Jesus heads back to his own Jewish territory and heals, therapeu, innumerable people who are at his feet. He also gives them bread, artos. Jesus heals many people and then feeds a multitude. This pattern, called chiasm, puts the attention on the center element, C, highlighting it as crucial. A, feeding bread to thousands in Galilee. B, healing many in Galilee. C, Canaanite woman and her daughter in Tyre and Sidon, who should receive bread and healing. B1, healing many in Galilee. A1, feeding bread to thousands in Galilee. The story is a watershed moment in the narrative where we learn that, in fact, the ministry of Jesus and the church extends across boundaries of many sorts. Traditional interpretations. Traditional interpretations of this passage fall into the following categories. 1. This is a test. It is only a test. The first line of interpretation sees the episode as Jesus testing the woman's faith and often attempts to downplay Jesus' harshness. According to this approach, Jesus intended all along to respond to her. Furthermore, the point is made that Jesus calls her a little dog, more like a puppy, such that it is a term of affection. A variation of this approach claims that Jesus is testing the disciples in the episode. 2. Faith as a prerequisite for healing. The second approach focuses upon the importance of faith for healing to occur. Jesus praises the woman's faith and grants healing on the basis of her faith. Often, her faith is seen as a foil for the lack of faith of the scribes and Pharisees, with whom Jesus is wrangling in this part of the narrative. 3. Jesus includes Gentiles. In the third approach, the point, because many interpretations assume that there can be only one point, is that the woman is a Gentile, and Jesus, unlike the scribes and Pharisees, accepts her as part of the people of God. The eventual inclusion of Gentiles is foreshadowed at certain places in the Gospel, including, perhaps, the genealogy. The arrival of the Magi, Zoroastrian priests, Matthew chapter 2, the healing of the centurion's servant, Matthew chapter 8, and the encounter with this woman. The earthly Jesus primarily came to the Jews as the promised Messiah. In this way, it can be said that God kept God's covenant with God's elect people. The resurrected Jesus and his disciples, in his name, have all nations as their scope. This would help Matthew's own church understand and explain why the church has both Jews and Gentiles in it. Whenever contemporary Christians take up the issue of how Gentiles fit into God's plan of salvation history, it becomes important to notice the potential for the interpretation to go off the rails in a variety of ways, including promoting anti-Semitism. Thus, a brief word is in order. Matthew's own historical context made for a variety of tensions between his church and the surrounding world. Usually thought to be in Syrian Antioch, where there was a substantial Jewish community, Matthew's own church contained both Jews and Gentiles near the end of the first century. Presumably, it was at least bilingual and bicultural. The first tension exhibited in Matthew, then, is that while Jesus is the fulfillment of the promises to Israel, his chief opponents are from that group. Perhaps Matthew's most vitriolic moment in this regard occurs at chapter 27, verse 25. Then the people as a whole answered, "His blood be on us and on our children." I imagine that Matthew, himself most likely a Jew speaking to a largely Jewish audience about a Jewish Messiah, would be horrified to discover that his love of hyperbole has resulted in a terrible history of anti-Semitism on the part of Christians over the centuries. Words matter and sometimes have unintended consequences. How might this play out in some interpretations of Matthew chapter 15, verses 21 through 28? Let me overstate the case for illustrative purposes. One might argue, Jews were ethnocentric and did not have dealings with Gentiles, especially Canaanites, the worst of Jewish enemies. Jesus, though a Jew, overcame his natural Jewish proclivities toward ethnocentrism and was more expansive and inclusive. He overcame and dissociated from his narrow Judaism and left it behind to become something totally different, a Gentile-accepting Christian. For a further analysis, I would point the listener to A.J. Levine's comment. Rather than view the narrative as hopelessly colonial or employ it to advance a super secessionist agenda, we might see the woman as another Rahab or Ruth. She recognizes her salvation is with Israel's representative, yet she retains her Canaanite identification. She proves more faithful than insiders, the spies in Jericho, the disciples, and she does what she must to save her family. 4. The importance of humility. In this interpretation, the woman's humility, expressed by prostrating herself and allowing the canine slur, gives all Christians a model to live by. At the granular level within each of these categories, one could include more detail or shades of nuance within these interpretive trajectories. These four, however, provide enough background for our purposes at present. We now turn our attention to newer interpretations. Newer interpretations. In most traditional interpretations, Jesus is the protagonist and hero of the story. Where the woman is highlighted, she is often painted as one who is acted upon by Jesus, rather than the one acting upon Jesus. Citing numerous commentaries, Gail O'Day notes, "There seems to be a resistance in scholarship on this text to credit the Canaanite woman with much more than submission to Jesus. Such a view of the Canaanite woman, however, is more determined by preconceptions about the relative positions of Jesus and the woman than by the details of the text itself. This woman does not quietly submit to Jesus, but takes him on directly. Her faith moves beyond stereotypes of female passivity. Innumerable articles on this passage take a newer interpretive approach, especially since 2000. In what follows, I acquaint the listener with some of the current interpretive trajectories. If you are looking for a single book that brings you relatively up to date on the recent productive lenses through which to view biblical texts, I recommend Mark and Method, New Approaches to Biblical Studies, edited by Janice Capel Anderson and Stephen D. Moore, 2nd edition. Sample of Feminist Interpretations. Feminist biblical interpretation has led interpreters to investigate the Canaanite woman from new angles. For instance, many would argue that the woman, not Jesus, is the protagonist and hero of the story. She helps Jesus imagine a wider scope for his ministry, and thus helps to shape his understanding of his vocation. Countless feminist interpretations have been conducted on this passage. In what follows, I sample only a few. Each one is an act of recovering the voice and significance of the woman, who is seen as strong, savvy, and even subversive. These interpretations do not feel a need to rescue Jesus from his humanity, and they do not sugarcoat his harsh treatment of the woman. As if stories involving gender were not complicated enough, ethnicity is a primary factor in this story as well. In fact, if one surveys feminist essays on this passage, one notices stages of interpretation. First are moves of recovery and reinterpretation. Then interpreters notice that the issue is far more complex than gender alone and includes considerations of class, of ethnicity, and more recently through post-colonial contributions, of empire. Make no mistake, empire is at least as live and well in our century as it was in Jesus's and Matthew's. Another move that feminists make in their recovery effort is to take note of who and what information is not in the story. Is there a father? How old is the daughter? Is she there? Feminists pay close attention to children, or lack thereof, in the narratives, because in antiquity, as now, there was a tight connection between the fate of women and the fate of children. In fact, in two different places, just before and just after our passage, the feedings of the 5,000 and the 4,000, Matthew overtly states that the women and children, unlike the men, are not even important enough to count. And those who ate were about 5,000 men, not counting, chorus, women and children. Matthew chapter 14, verse 21, my translation. Those who had eaten were 4,000 men, not counting, chorus, women and children. Matthew chapter 15, verse 38, my translation. One act of recovery, then, would be to start counting and naming women in the Bible. Megan McKenna writes about this issue in her book, Not Counting Women and Children, Neglected Stories from the Bible. Not counting women and children. People react to that phrase in different ways, some with laughter, others with anger, sadness, or disgust. Especially when read aloud, that phrase hangs suspended in the air, like a bait on a hook for a fish. One person responds, "I feel excluded." Another complains, "Women and children are put in the same category." Such responses are countered, "But we are all the children of God," theological reaction to emotion. Or, "But they all were fed and everyone was satisfied, full." It is amazing that in a culture where we characterize men as the dominant group, and men are still dominant in the church in many ways, that line is even in the text. Furthermore, sociologists say that when you gather a crowd of men, women, and children, the ratio of women and children to men can be as high as 5 or 6 to 1. So the story is really the feeding of the 35,000. Thus, if we are going to count honestly, let's start calling this feeding story the feeding of the 35,000. In all of these stories about handing out divine bread, Matthew 15 and the feeding miracles, the women and children stand on the margins. The woman as a paradigm of faith. New interpretations of the Bible also note that, in addition to being charged with the care of children, usually without pay, women have historically been tasked with caring for the ill as well, usually without pay. Matthew 15, then, features a woman suffering a double burden, caring for a child who is ill. If there is no male provider, she is further disadvantaged. In this story, she attempts to get help from some powerful males, and that becomes, in large part, a harrowing experience of humiliation. Like the woman with the flow of blood in Matthew 9, the Canaanite woman is unnamed and not explicitly tied to a male. Her social standing is not given. Is she what we would call a single mother? Martina Nat sees the woman as a proselyte or God-fearer because she knows and subscribes to the traditions of the Jews, son of David, etc. She is said to have great, megas, faith. Conversely, the disciples are designated as having little faith, oligopistos. The woman sees more than Jesus does. In contrast to Jesus, the woman has an inclusive vision of the wholeness God offers, and she holds it fast in the face of persistent attempts to get rid of her. And in the end, she is proven right. Jesus makes a fundamental change in his attitude. He has been shown the better way. What is so striking about this story is that here Jesus is espousing a position that in the course of the discussion is shown to be short on faith and is overcome. That confers authority on the woman's point of view. It cannot be set aside without further ado. On the contrary, it has such an inner weight that it must be wrestled with. In this interpretation, the woman is a paradigm of faith to be emulated, whose persistence and courage benefit many, including at least her daughter, Jesus, the disciples, the early church, and us, the contemporary readers. A Jewish Lament. O'Day's treatment of Matthew chapter 15, verses 21 through 28, focuses upon three aspects of the story. A. The irony of the Canaanite woman as the quintessential Jew in the narrative. B. The way the woman shapes Jesus. And C. How the reader might be shaped by the narrative. Irony is subversive in its own way. O'Day seeks to show that our passage is a narrative embodiment of a lament psalm. In the lament psalms, such as Psalm 13, Israel boldly approaches God in the midst of her pain, need, and despair, and implores God to rise to the occasion of assisting her, to remain actively faithful to the promises made long ago. O'Day analyzes the eight moves made in a traditional lament psalm, starting with address and concluding with praise. She then maps the story of the Canaanite woman onto this model and argues that, ironically, it's the Canaanite woman who plays the role of Israel in her bold entreaty and her faithful conviction that she deserves to be helped and that she will be helped by the Lord. This Canaanite woman is more faithful, indeed, more authentically Jewish, than many of the Jews whom Jesus encounters. She is a fuller embodiment of Jewish traditions than Jesus' own disciples, who want to dismiss her because she is a foreigner and an irritant. She is not a Jew. She is, nevertheless, fully Jewish. O'Day stresses not only that the woman is a Gentile female, but again, even a Canaanite. Furthermore, her faith is anything but submissive. On the contrary, Jesus was changed by this woman's boldness. She insists that Jesus be Jesus, and through her insistence, she frees him to be fully who he is. O'Day concludes by calling us readers to, like Jesus himself, listen to her and be transformed through a faith like hers, persistent, vigorous, and confident in God's faithfulness to God's promises. Introducing Justa. Elaine Wainwright's passion for this passage shows in the fact that she has reconsidered it from various angles over her career. Consult, for example, Shall We Look for Another?, The Gospel of Matthew, and Not Without My Daughter. She reminds us of the importance of naming, reclaiming, and remembering. For her, Matthew evinces numerous tensions. First, Matthew presents Jesus as being in tension with his own tradition. Jesus is the fulfillment of promises made to Israel, but he is opposed by the leaders of Israel who seek to kill him. As seen earlier, at one point, all of Jerusalem cries out, "His blood will be on us and our children." Matthew chapter 27, verse 25. Second, there is ethnic tension in the Gospel of Matthew. On the one hand, Jesus came to make disciples of all nations, ethne, Matthew chapter 28, verse 19. On the other hand, he says he came only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. This tension inheres not only in the Gospel of Matthew as a whole, but also in our passage. Third, there is gender tension. The tension is also visible, on the other hand, in relation to gender, which is the significant concern in this commentary. Indications have already been given of the inclusion of women within the Basileia vision and praxis of Jesus. Yet the Matthean Gospel constructs a symbolic universe that is androcentric and encodes the patriarchal constructs present in its socio-historical location. The text creates a world in which the male norm is coterminous with the human, and this presupposition finds expression in the grammatical and narrative strategies of the text, resulting in the marginalization of women. The use of masculine language and examples, sons, fathers, men, brothers, obscures women and makes the male the norm for discipleship. Only four women appear in Matthew's genealogy, that is, they are exceptions. Jerome calls them sinners, and Luther calls them outsiders. So, not only Matthew, but also later interpreters obscure the place of women in Jesus' ministry. In her essay, Not Without My Daughter, Gender and Demon Possession in Matthew chapter 15, verses 21 through 28, Wainwright highlights the importance of naming. She insists that we should refer to the Canaanite woman as Justa, the name given her in the afterlife of the story. The pseudo-Clementine epistles give the name Justa to the Canaanite woman. I have chosen to use this name throughout this paper in order that in the reclamation of the story, the naming of the woman may lead to her story being remembered in contemporary Christian telling of the story. Unnamed characters tend to be forgotten more easily than those who have been given names, and female characters in the gospel story especially. Named female characters are fewer than named male characters. The naming of women characters, especially when that naming belongs within the Christian tradition, can assist in bringing them to the center of the Christian remembering. Wainwright turns to an analysis of the daughter by attending to the interconnection of gender and ethnicity. She determines that demon possession, which is more prevalent in Greco-Roman sources than Jewish, does not tend to be gendered. While the healer, exorcist is usually male, the afflicted person can be either gender. What stands out in Matthew is that those who have a demon exorcised from them and are then declared as healed using the Greek word iaomai, as in our case, are Gentiles. That is, this is the same word used for the centurion's servant in Matthew 8. Thus, the focus on the ethnicity of Justa and her daughter stands out. Woman Wisdom. Stuart Love connects the Canaanite woman to Israel's wisdom tradition through the ideal woman of Proverbs chapter 31, as well as Ruth. He treats each figure in turn. He argues in reference to the Canaanite woman, she too should be given an everlasting name as a foreigner who honors the God of Israel, even if her status is that of a liminal person. She, like the women of the genealogy, wise women in their life settings, courageously speaks and behaves as a capable, worthy woman whose strength is manifest in her persistence with Jesus. Wisdom is seen in her behavior. Wisdom is revealed in her language. There is no other such example in Matthew. She is a capable, worthy, and wise person who teaches Jesus. Given that Matthew depicts Jesus himself in terms of woman wisdom in Matthew chapter 11, verses 28 through 30, Consult Chapter 8, Jesus Across Gender. Interpreting the Canaanite woman with that trajectory elevates her and her powerful witness to the gospel in the gospel. Critique from Jewish feminists. Jewish feminists take issue with some Christian feminist interpretations of the passage as anti-Jewish on a number of counts. They argue that it is wrong, A, to present Judaism as particularly biased against women, Gentiles, and the sick as impure, and B, then to depict Jesus as uniquely overcoming the biases of his native Judaism. It leaves the impression that Judaism and Christianity were both in existence at the time of Jesus, they were not, and that Jesus was more a Christian than a Jew. That is, it inappropriately suggests that all the bad behaviors or motivations ascribed in Matthew to characters such as the scribes and Pharisees, for example, are representative of Judaism, while Jesus goes against his native Judaism when he interacts graciously with women, Gentiles, and ill people. Amy Jill Levine raises some questions along these lines. Some readers understand the woman as the post-colonial Christian who must subjugate herself and her culture to obtain the West's benefits. For others, the story shows Jesus moving beyond the ideology of chosenness to embrace Christian universalism. However, chosenness need not be an oppressive ideology. It is precisely that ideology that helps groups persevere despite persecution, and it is how the church saw itself. Also, Jesus does not insist that the woman become Jewish to receive the healing. This is an ironic difference from the so-called universalism of those claiming salvation only through Jesus. Rather than view the narrative as hopelessly colonial or employ it to advance a supersessionist agenda, we might see the woman as another Rahab or Ruth. She recognizes her salvation is with Israel's representative, yet she retains her Canaanite identification. She proves more faithful than insiders, the spies in Jericho, the disciples, and she does what she must to save her family. LGBTQIA+ readings. Women are not the only minoritized group who find hope in this passage. For LGBTQIA+ interpreters, the story inspires in at least two ways. First, those who are currently marginalized as outsiders are encouraged to fight for inclusion. A queer interpretation of this story remembers that often the Christian church, like Jesus in the story, is reluctant to give queer folk our just desserts. Frequently, queer activists must resort to extraordinary means to get a hearing. Second, the Canaanite woman models acting up. Here I allude to the ACT UP movement, AIDS Coalition to Unleash Power, an advocacy group that operated in legal, medical, and social realms. The woman's assertive faith leads to inclusive justice for all of God's children. Thus, in addition to calling for bold activism on behalf of the marginalized, the story shows that Jesus himself ordains inclusivity beyond our, and originally his, wildest imaginations. A queering of Matthew sees hope in this radical inclusivity that pushes the justice of God beyond human conventions and comfort levels, and will thus even overcome the predisposition of many toward intolerance and homophobia. We could multiply examples of minoritized readings, but at this point, the listener can notice the interpretive strategies involved, which include pressing the Christian community in all times and places to widen the net of inclusion. Post-colonial readings. Post-colonial critics have much to work with in this passage. Warren Carter has done much good work on post-colonial criticism as it illuminates the New Testament, especially the Gospels. Consult his Matthew and Empire. For a general primer, consult Carter's The Roman Empire and the New Testament. In both Jesus's and Matthew's time, Palestine was occupied by Rome. Rome crucified Jesus and many other Jews as well. After Jesus died, but before the Gospel of Matthew appeared, Rome burnt the Jewish Second Temple to the ground and expelled the Jews from Jerusalem. In addition to operating under Gentile Roman rule, no matter where the Gospel of Matthew was composed, Matthew's community had to address ethnic tensions in its midst between Jews and Gentiles. How is a Christian community supposed to relate to the government at any given moment? How is a Christian community supposed to define its boundaries and establish its identity, especially when it is at odds with both its parent tradition, Judaism, and the ruling government? How does one live in and for God's empire while Caesar and his systems are alive and well? How is Matthew's community a subversive community with a counter-narrative? Caesar Augustus claimed to be a divine savior who brought healing, salvation, and peace, Pax Romana. The whole system, of course, was built on power, violence, injustice, and oppression. Christians told a counter-narrative about a Messiah who brought true healing, salvation, and peace. Part of that involved healing stories. Thomas Bahachi notes, "A post-colonial reading of Matthew sees his exorcisms as a way of overcoming the evils of imperialism and colonialism that seem incurable." For most of the history of scholarship, interpretation has been done by Western males. With the rise of feminism, female Western voices were added. Finally, we are hearing from global voices, many of whom have lived under imperial rule. They have shed new light on the ways the Gospels resist and undermine empire, and the ways they inadvertently collude with and propagate the values of Caesar. I have preached on Matthew chapter 15, verses 21 through 28 a number of times from various angles and find it endlessly fascinating. I also used it as a test case for an exercise in The Politics of Biblical Interpretation in Engaging the Word. In that chapter, I touch on various interpretive lenses and wrote this concerning aspects of post-colonial interpretation. The passage is rich with potential for post-colonial analysis, as it is rife with political, economic, racial, and ethnic boundary issues. Clearly, Israel is privileged in this.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.